Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, regardless of where you are and which time zone you're at. My name is Alexander Azadgan, professor of international political economy and strategic global management, as well as a senior geopolitical analyst with Iran's Press TV, other global media, and several Russian and Iranian think tanks. We just gave an interview to Press TV regarding Lebanese Hezbollah's defeat of al-Nusra Salafist terrorists in this in the outskirts of this Lebanese town of Arsal, which is located in the Lebanon-Syria border. This is a major victory against the terrorist savages. The al-Nusra front, or whatever other name they go by these days, is an organization that warmongering Zionists senators like John McCain and Lindsey Graham call moderates, okay? Moderates. And looks like Mr. McCain is getting what he deserves, which is brain cancer, a brain that was never functional to begin with after his imprisonment by the Vietnamese in the 1960s, where he was cowardly dropping hundreds of bombs on the defenseless Vietnamese people. Anyway, these are the people. I'm not talking about the Vietnamese. I'm talking about these savages, these Salafist and Wahhabi savages in Syria that Mr. McCain and Lindsey Graham and many of these neocon, warmongering, pro-Israel senators in our Congress are calling moderates. This only goes to prove that when Hezbollah is involved, as it has been in this conflict, at the invitation of the legitimate government of Bashar al-Assad, once they put their heart into something, they can achieve major victories. This is the same Lebanese Hezbollah, which defeated Israel in Israel's 2006 imposed war against Lebanon. Hezbollah has tremendous popularity among all Lebanese people, obviously the Shia, as well as the Sunni, the moderate Sunni, and our Christian brothers and sisters, as well as major popularity in the Arab street across the Muslim world. So for those of you, for my detractors, those lackeys who not too long ago challenged me on the Turkish TRT World Channel, in proving that Hezbollah is popular in the Arab world, I would recommend to these lackeys and these terrorist supporting media pundits to look at all the celebration that's going on now across Syria, as well as other places in Middle East where they have been affected deeply by these ISIS savages in places like Syria, in places like Iraq, and in all these other places where Libya, they have affiliates literally everywhere. In Nigeria, it's called Boko Haram over there, the ISIS affiliates or Al-Qaeda affiliates. Even in Philippines, they have a chapter. This is basically an example of when you have a major military militia force like Hezbollah. Once they enter the battlefield, because they are so good in partisan warfare, and really this conflict of these terrorist savages, these Wahhabi, Salafists, ISIS, al-Nusra, whatever hell you want to call them, these savages, in order to defeat them, I mean, there's so much bombs you can drop, as our Russian colleagues are doing, which in some cases are indiscriminatory, and civilians are dead. But whenever you have a militia force like Lebanese Hezbollah enter the battlefield, then you have these major victories. Now, altogether, we have to also mention that this town Arsal, which is in the outskirts of the Lebanese, it is in the outskirts. The defeat of al-Nusra in the outskirts of Arsal, which is very close to the Lebanese-Syria border, also shows how close the al-Nusra people, or even ISIS, wants to get to Lebanon. They really want to create another major civil war in Lebanon, just like the one they had in 1975, which went all the way to pretty much the end of 80s. This is, of course, all the doing of the Zionist entity. The Zionist entity totally mis-strategized by supporting these savages, trying to create some kind of a buffer between itself as well as Hezbollah and Syria. And we are seeing that strategy totally being defeated. Of course, these days, everybody is against ISIS, even NATO and Washington. Washington has at least 11 illegal bases in southern Syria. And from what we are deciphering from the last shooting down of a Syrian Sukhoi 22 jet when it was getting close to this particular rebel group called SDF, I believe it stands for Syrian Democratic Forces. This is a militia group that is totally now being supported by Washington, which is made up of 40% is made up of Kurds and 60% of Arabs, in many cases obviously Wahhabi and Salafist Arabs, and most of the fighting is done by YPG, which is another militant Kurdish force. So unfortunately, we see Washington and some countries in NATO have not learned a damn lesson from having supported these ISIS savages and al-Nusra and all these al-Sham this, al-Sham that group. They haven't learned from that, and now they're actually the Kurds. I'm very, very disappointed in the Kurds, be it the Syrian Kurds or the Iraqi Kurds or the Turkish Kurds that are part of this SDF, YPG sort of terrorist group, so-called rebel group that are trying to overthrow the legitimate government of Syria. And Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, I'm highly disappointed. It seems they haven't learned a damn thing from the defeat of ISIS, the imminent defeat of ISIS in Iraq, as we are seeing in the city of Mosul and other towns, as well as many towns and cities in Syria, and that Washington is really going to use these people now to create discord and essentially try to implement its federalization of not just Syria, but many Middle Eastern countries, in particular four countries that have major Kurdish population: Syria, Turkey, Iraq, and Iran. We also are fully aware that the Israelis for a long time have been wanting a separate Kurdistan. They express sympathy and they try to put a lot of fuel on the fire of some Kurdish separatist groups' tendencies to want to separate from those four countries, aforementioned countries that I just mentioned. And this is at the step two, or the contingency plan, if ISIS or al-Nusra and all these other terrorist groups in Syria were to be defeated as they are being defeated. So Washington is going to level two of its federalization of the Middle East plan, and in particular those four countries that I named that have significant the Kurdish population. Of course, by doing so, it's going to completely destroy their Turkish desire to at least occupy parts of northern Syria, as they have been doing or having the tendency to want to do all these over-the-border skirmishes with the Syrian and the Syrian Kurdish forces that the Turkish army has been participating in. So this is going to make a very strange bedfellow between the Syrians and the Turks in order to defeat the Kurdish separatists. The biggest private investors in the Iraqi Kurdistan, which for all means and purposes has been federalized, if you travel to Iraqi Kurdistan, or as we like to call it, northern Iraq, the Kurds make sure you're in a different country. The northern Iraq or Iraqi Kurdistan is de facto a separate nation. They make sure they fly their Kurdish flag as big and as frequent as possible. And the biggest investor, as I was saying, in Kurdistan are Israeli capitalists and private investors. So they believe that by federalizing Iraq, parts of eastern Turkey, which happens to be, Turkey is an Israeli ally. Many Israeli tanks are being manufactured or assembled in Turkey. Okay, the situation hasn't exactly been, fantastic between Erdogan and Netanyahu, because of what happened in the Turkish flotilla a few years ago when the Israeli commandos attacked and killed some people on the flotilla, as well as take that Turkish flotilla into custody. The situation is not exactly great between Turkey and Israel. Nevertheless, they have been traditional allies, unfortunately. Our Turkish colleagues have been picking the wrong side over and over again. But the Israelis are not going to give up now that their proxies, and by that I mean the ISIS, the Daesh, Takfiri savages, terrorist savages, are being defeated, and that buffer that they wanted to create between themselves and Syria, especially in the Golan Heights, is being taken away. Now they're going to, along with other superpowers, especially Washington, they're going to support these SDF and YPG and all these other Kurdish separatist groups. The shooting down of the Syrian jet, the Sukhoi 22, the Russian-made Sukhoi 22 jet that happened a few weeks ago, was very hypocritical, because the Turks have been also attacking the same Kurdish forces in southern Syria, where, as I mentioned, Washington has at least 11 illegal bases. The Turks have been bombing those positions, and they're obviously their jets never got shot down. But when the Syrians are doing that, our Syrian colleagues are doing that, we see how strong Washington's response has been, which goes to say Washington is totally protecting these Kurdish terrorist separatists, and they're going to be phase two of this savage war that's been basically going on since 2011 against Syria. And by the very fact that Washington has at least 11 illegal bases in Syria goes to tell us they do not, I repeat, they do not want a political settlement to this horrible conflict. All they want is to accentuate it. All they want is to deplete the Syrian nation of its resources. All they want to do is bankrupt the Syrian nation. Of course, when you have Iran and Russia involved in this conflict, this makes it quite dangerous, and it the Iranian and the Russians are not going to go away anytime soon unless our Russian colleagues capitulate and want to settle for some kind of a solution vis-a-vis the Kurds in Syria, and they would want to give a certain part of Syria and or make it into an autonomous region for the Syrian Kurds. God forbid, if that happens, the Iraqi Kurds are going to be even more invigorated, and that would clearly bring the Turks into this conflict on the side of Iraq and Syria in trying to defeat the Kurds, because God forbid there would be a separate Kurdish entity in Turkey that would practically break that nation into two parts, because there's a significant Kurdish population in the east and southeastern parts of Turkey. At any rate, I hope I managed to shed some light for you in this brief analysis of what's going on. Let's hope and pray for more victories of the Syrian Arab Republic Army, the only legitimate the Syrian force that is fighting against the terrorists. Let's hope and pray for Syria, who is a force for righteousness and good. And unlike what our Saudi adversaries quite regularly label them as a terrorist organization, I think we all know who the greatest state sponsor of terrorism in this region is, and that's none other than the Wahhabi, backward-minded, misogynist country or state, vassal state of Saudi-controlled Arabia. So let's hope and pray that our Syrian, our Lebanese colleagues, we have to also mention the courageous Lebanese army, which is allowing Syria to do the fighting, and who is on the side of Syria, who has been, in fact, supporting Hezbollah with a certain type of tank. I believe it's called M113 tanks, and everybody knows in that part of the world, in this part of the Middle East, the greatest supplier and the greatest proprietor of these M113 tanks are none other than the Lebanese army. So the Lebanese army is clearly on the side of good. The Lebanese army is clearly on the side of Syria. The Lebanese army is clearly on the side of Hezbollah. in order to make sure this crazy, violent, evil, murderous war that Washington and its NATO supporters, along with the help of these Saudi terrorists, have been incurring on Syria. Our Lebanese colleagues are making sure this war never infiltrates and never spreads to Libya. I'm sorry, to Lebanon, which has a tremendous potential, unfortunately, to go back to a horrible sectarian civil war as it did in the mid-70s all the way to the end of 80s. And that was when the Christians, our Christian Lebanese friends, our Sunni Lebanese friends, and our Shia Lebanese friends were at each other's throats. And behind the whole thing, of course, was the Zionist criminal terrorist supporting state of Israel, which was wreaking all the benefits. And in 1982, of course, Syria actually invaded and occupied parts of southern Lebanon. And from that occupation came out, of course, the organization of Hezbollah came into existence. So it goes to say that every time they try to incur evil, something good comes out of it. Of course, many people were murdered, civilians and what have you. But from that occupation in 1982 all the way down to when the last Israeli occupying forces left Lebanon, it only strengthened Hezbollah to become a very viable military force, not just in Lebanon, but across the Middle East, rapid deployment force, and a force that actually defeated Israel in the Israeli-imposed war against Lebanon in 2006. So, it's interesting. All things work for good. All things work for righteousness. And evil is being defeated slowly, albeit surely, in the borders of Syria and Israel. Thank you so much for watching this analysis. If you have not subscribed to this YouTube channel, please go ahead and do so. It will be an honor to have more subscribers. You will get regular updates of our video uploads, whether there would be analysis like this or our interviews in global media such as Press TV and others. As always, keep the faith alive and let your hearts not be troubled in these troubled times. Thank you and have a wonderful day.